Welcome to the Dynamo Show. This is episode 29. My name is James Erdt. I am the chief architect of WOW for Dynamo Entrepreneur, a brand that supports entrepreneurs predominantly who are living well and doing good in the world. Speakers, authors, internet marketers, socialpreneurs, people that are living in the digital world and also in the 3D world. Once in a while, we kind of get out of the borders. We kind of stray a little bit to, you know, the musical side of things. And we have a musician here today, and he's one of my favorites. His name is Temi.
Yeah, man. How you doing?
How are you?
Good. Thank you for having me, man.
Oh, I am so honored to have you here. I love, love your music. I'm going to ask you to sing, so I'm going to put that right out there.
Let's do it.
Right here, right now. But I'm not going to do it right now.
All
right. Okay, I'm just kind of prepping, you know, you right. and prepping our audience to... Let them know what's ahead. All but right. before we get into that, let's talk Temi. Let's talk youth. I know you're big on supporting youth now, and usually those that are supporting youth have somewhat of a challenging life that they've kind of gone through.
Right.
Care to share the journey?
The reason, I guess getting right into why I decided to start supporting youth and getting into youth mentoring as well was because when I grew up, being an African-born, I mean, coming from there, you didn't really get a chance to express yourself in an artistic way.
What country?
Nigeria.
Okay.
Nigeria.
So I have many friends in Nigeria.
Right.
One of my best friends, half Nigerian, half Indian. Oh. Mom's Indian, dad's All
right.
Nigerian.
All right. Yeah. An interesting mix.
Yeah. Obadike. Michael Obadike. All
right.
Yeah.
All
good,
right.
good. Continue, please.
No problem. Here
we are in Canada.
generally, I think what happened was it was not having the chance to express myself as a child because I was either supposed to be a doctor, a lawyer, or whatever it is they wanted me to be. So. Then when I finally, you know, came up, I'm like, you know, let me give somebody else an opportunity to do something, to show them that there's actually can be a career in music, not just a dream in music as well, too.
So I ran
an artist development program that helps with that.
Mm-hmm. And this was like your passion from like Always. Back home all the way through. You kind of knew you were going to move into the arts, move into
Always,
music.
Yeah. Ever since I heard my brother playing Bobby Brown on his on his little tape deck.
Nice. I used to love Bobby Brown. I did that too. Yeah. Right on. So tell us about maybe like a day in the life of Temi.
A day in the life. I'm lazy, man. I don't do. I'm joking.
Come on.
No, I mean, honestly, a day in the life of me. I try to get up, go to the gym, work out. Obviously, like everybody else tries to do. My vocal train in the morning as well, too. Mm. And then handle their phone calls.
Where do you vocal train?
At home. Vocal train at home. Or with my vocal trainer, Paula.
Yeah.
Whenever I get a chance.
Paula Abdul.
Yeah, you know, Paula Abdul. you know, her and her and Mariah have just I'm sorry. No, but I just wake up in the morning, vocal train, get our things done, get the phone calls done, get to work, go to the studio and have some youth come in. Into the studio, get some recording sessions done with them and stuff like that. So that's
what age group are you working with?
Anywhere from 11 to 21.
Okay. Yeah, we're predominantly 12 to 17.
Right.
We might expand that to 18, 19, but you know, once you hit 18, things are different.
Right.
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 So you know how that is. So I mean, influence. Mm-hmm. Okay. Like especially in music, you know, there's so many musical influences. Personally, I'm more influenced by speakers like Tony Robbins, you know, right. T. Harv Eker, right. Robin Sharma, mm-hmm. these influential speaker types mm-hmm. that have driven my career. Who's driven your career?
I would say I learned, I kind of got my passion from singing from some of the groups, some of the Boyz II Men's and stuff like that, the Jodeci's even.
Yeah.
And then when the solo singers like the Tanks, the Tyrese's, the R. Kelly's and stuff like that, not the bad stuff he did, the good stuff. But only
they
bad
all
stuff.
Do bad stuff.
They it's all just do like happens, it, right?
You know, some don't get
caught. No, but I mean, sure, he's a great artist, amazing artist.
Yeah, you got to respect the voice for
definitely,
sure.
Definitely. Yeah. But yeah, just things like that. I mean, artists like that with real, real talent and real, real soul in their music was where I learned that from. And then, yeah.
Very cool, very cool. Yeah. Do you remember Snow?
Yes.
And Fall. Yeah, yeah. So I'm actually working on a track, and I just got the good news that he's going to help me with my my vocal training.
All right.
Right? So to spit lyrics and enunciate them properly, in a way that I can spit them nicely. So
I might have to get on that track.
You might have to be on that track. You know what? Let's talk about that after. Right. If you were to, let's say, put you into three words, okay? Just off the top of your head, Temi, three words.
Passion, music, love.
Passion, music, and love. Yeah. Beautiful. Now, with passion, music, and love, do you relay that to the youth that you work with?
Yeah.
Yeah? How?
Well, music, obviously.
Yeah.
I work with them in music and arts development. Passion, it's all in one. And the reason I say it's because when I speak to the youth and I have them do music, any song they do, any track, any record they might do, I make sure that they're speaking from the soul, and make sure that they're speaking realism into their music and not just gimmicky stuff, but realism. And that just brings passion. You're speaking about yourself, you're speaking about experiences you've gone through. And I think that it just makes you fall in love with the music at the same time, period. It makes everybody else fall in love with not only the music, but yourself as an artist. Mm-hmm. So all those things just encompass, I think.
So important.
Yeah.
You know, the kids that are coming in, I mean, is passion something that is inherently within them in their genes, or is it something that can be created for them?
Sometimes it's something where they just catch on. Sometimes they got to just find it. Sometimes they don't know all the way, it's, you know, they don't know they can do it.
Like
they don't have the confidence.
Like if an 11-year-old comes in, that's going to be a different situation.
Of course.
Yeah, different.
When the younger, it's mostly the confidence. That's the idea. That's where it comes down to.
I bet. Any claim to fame from coming out of the school? Anyone that's you see is on the right track now and possibly has a career in music?
I have a few youths that are doing very, very well. I know one youth that's working with Wonder Girl, who's she did Jay-Z's one of Jay-Z's tracks on his record. So one of the youth I have now I'm working with, he's currently producing and working with them. And a few youth are definitely performing at different places around the city of Toronto. So I'm happy about that. I feel like a proud father.
Oh, I bet, I bet. And you go support them when they...
I do. I definitely go out to these shows and I'm in the front row screaming and shit. Yeah,
I'm
that guy. Yeah.
That's awesome. Let's talk Studio 2. Studio 2 School.
Okay.
You know, tell us a little bit about that. I know it's close and dear to your heart.
It's honestly the same thing. What happened was Studio 2 School was just a fork in the road. And it just... Well, not even a fork in the road, but it was another branch that happened where I was already doing it with the City of Toronto. Mm-hmm. And then it just kind of developed.
So you were actually working with the city?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay,
I'm currently working with the City of Toronto now.
Great.
Yeah, yeah. So, but
I did not know that. I thought it was like your private thing.
No, I'm currently working with the City of Toronto. I do City of Toronto as well as Native Child Youth Center.
Yeah.
And then as well, I do Studio to Schools.
Oh, great.
So they kind of just all...
very good.
Across.
So you got the Indigenous connection in there,
exactly.
Too. Yeah, working closely with them, too.
Yeah, very, very amazing community.
Oh,
a lot of culture. Yeah. It's just amazing.
We got do you know David Miracle?
I don't.
You heard of him? He's an Indigenous percussionist.
Okay.
Plays like everything like you can imagine. It's just the most beautiful music. So
dope.
I'll connect you. He's actually on our track as well.
Please, I can definitely bring him to the center.
Yeah. So now I would love to maybe share a little bit of your voice with our potentially 2 million reach. How does that make you feel?
I think that feels good.
Yeah. I'll leave it to you.
Have I told you I love you lately? Have I told you you still mean the world to me? Have I told you I love you? I'll be your wishing well. Tell me what you want. Oh. Thank you.
Yeah. What's up? Okay, my turn.
Let's get it.
later. That's for after the commercial break. However, what we're going to do right now is we're going to play a little game.
Okay.
We're going to talk Temi 5 years from now.
All right, let's do
day
it.
In the life of Temi 5 years from now.
Okay. Day in the life of Temi 5 years from now?
Yeah.
Okay. pick up the phone. Sorry, wake up in the morning, my phone's ringing. It's James. Temi, get up. Temi, get up. What are you doing? You have a show to go to. I'm just here to be that speaker, that voice in your ear. You have a show to go to, then you got a tour, and you got this studio session with Jay-Z lined up. What are you doing? That's my day in the life.
Where's the tour? Where are you headed?
The tour is in Dubai.
Nice, yeah. Nice. Why Dubai?
I love the place.
Interesting. Like,
I've never been before. It looks like a dream.
I have that on my vision board. That's like my number one city to go to right now. Yeah. I haven't been there yet.
It looks like a dream.
I've got my resume in a few companies to speak corporately.
Nice.
But it's what an amazing project.
It's just...
Are you a tech guy?
I am, super techy.
Yeah, me too. Yeah. I love it. On a final note, let's talk to some of the kids, okay? 30 seconds, maybe share with our audience some nuggets of wisdom from Temi to some youth that have possibly lost their way.
If you're going to do something, do it with your whole heart or don't do it at all. That's all I got.
Awesome. Temi, Yaman. Very good. This is James Erdt. This is the Dynamo Show. This is episode 29. Stay tuned after this short commercial break. We will be back. Hello, this is James Erdt of the Dynamo Show. I am the chief architect of WOW for a brand called Dynamo Entrepreneur. Moving things along, we have our second guest on the show today, Elena Kulikova.
Hello, pleasure to see you again.
We've been running into each other now at some really cool networking events. Joel Martin, he was actually here on the show a couple shows ago, and I know he's a dear, dear friend of yours.
He absolutely is.
And he's highly recommended you, and I want to know why. But before we get into that, and I have a good idea of why, but let's take it back. Let's take it back to your youth. Is there any stuff that you've kind of gone through on your journey to kind of get to where you are now?
Sure, yes, absolutely. So, you know, coming here at 12 years old, a family of engineers, immigrants, right? The typical immigrant story. Father used to do really great things back home, came here working for $5 an hour to feed a family of four. You know, we definitely saw a lot of furniture picked up on the side of the road in order to bring it into our house, right?
Okay.
Shopped at secondhand stores. So money was very tight, right? Mm-hmm. So coming from that, seeing my parents and being inspired by their work ethic and how they wanted to pour into myself and my sister, right? And they were very adamant.
Younger, older?
Younger sister.
Younger, okay,
4 years younger.
Yeah.
So they were very adamant about getting a great education so you have a solid job and you know, a great career, and which is what I did. My sister and I, actually, we've adopted their work ethic, and you know, I've gone through my schooling, all A's, and constantly worked overtime, like until 2 a.m. I'd be sitting there.
Brainiac.
Workaholic. Just work ethic, right?
Yeah,
not
yeah,
so
yeah.
much brainiac. I wouldn't say I'm the smartest person, just I work hard.
Very good.
You know, and so, yes, went to school, got an education, got myself an amazing job.
What did you go to school for?
I went to school for sales and marketing at York University.
Oh,
right?
Great school.
Uh-huh. Yeah, yeah. And then I've actually found myself in the corporate world. So for the last 14 years, I've been in the corporate world. I started very young, at the age of 18, right? So I just aged myself. But having said that, you know, I feel that I've already gone through that transition with corporate that many people get to when they're late 30s or early 40s, right? And I was actually at age 23, I was managing the distribution sales channel for Panasonic Canada.
Oh, wow.
So traveling.
Big job, lots of responsibility.
Oh, yeah. Lots of responsibility.
What would you say is the biggest thing you learned in that experience, just off the cuff?
The biggest thing I've learned was standing your ground and knowing what it is you're going after, right? Whether it's...
I like that.
Yes. Well, you know, at 23, I found myself amongst people in the, you know, middle age, then you have to fight for what's yours, right?
Yeah,
I had to really quickly learn that. And it's part of being, you know, in corporate as well. So
that's a big company.
It's a huge company. But having said that, you know, I realized very quickly, I've gone through corporate layoffs. as well, right? So on the fourth time, they caught me as well, and it was just a tumultuous time for the organization at the time. I was totally cool with it, but what I would
stressful.
What stuck with me wasn't as stressful. What stuck with me is that putting in 70, 80-hour work weeks, working for a corporation, traveling, you know, day in, day out, having it stress my personal life, right? And then just not having the courtesy of even going upstairs to pick up your things, right? And, your position's been eliminated. Thank you very much.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. So that stuck with me. And I said, you know what? I don't ever want to feel that way again. You know, someone coming out of left field and just completely controlling my income, controlling where I'm going to go in the future. And I know there's a lot of people from the corporate environment that can relate over the last few years.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
I feel you. Been there. Been there, done that.
Yeah.
Never again.
Exactly. So that is the decision. I think that was one of the key turning points for me when I said, you know what? Corporate is amazing and it's great. And after having the fantastic cars and the condos and you know, the designer stuff, it's not that important, you know? So I said, I would rather venture out on my own and do other amazing things, right?
Now let's talk about those other amazing things,
sure.
Because I know a big passion of yours is music.
It absolutely
care
is.
To share?
Sure.
Yeah.
So when I was young, I was in a choir and always wanted to sing. I actually grew up, even moving here, I grew up on Mariah Carey, right? And just Christina Aguilera, all those singers. And so I've always wanted to sing, and it actually not until 3 years ago did I say, there's so much business in my life. There's so much corporate, this, you know, even running business projects, I would consult for startups, sales and marketing strategies as well. And I needed an outlet, a creative outlet. And so I started teaching piano lessons to students, right? And then I started singing. So that helped me deal with all the stresses of, you know, sales targets or clients and et cetera. So, and it was because
you let it out through your voice.
That's right.
And I've heard her sing. She is absolutely phenomenal. I heard her sing at the My Empire. Oh, no, the open mic.
Open mic, yes.
That was cool. Open mic night, and you hit it out of the park.
And it was actually, you know, Joelle's event at the open mic. And so it was actually because of Joelle Martin, and I tell them this all the time, that last couple of years, I've started singing live at all these live events that he's been hosting.
Oh, cool.
Hired a number of coaches for public live singing, in studio singing, recording, and I'm actually now collaborating with an artist, an R&B artist, where we're gonna have a song coming out.
Are you gonna play it at the open mic?
Hopefully,
practice?
We'll see. Yeah. Right?
Can I tell you a secret?
Sure.
Okay, just so nobody knows. Okay, I've actually chosen Joelle's open mic to perform for the first time ever a song that I'm working on with Joel Casmy.
No way!
Yeah.
And Joel Casmy is amazing.
I haven't even told Joelle yet, so. Just,
wow.
Maybe this show won't come out before I do it. I don't know.
Okay.
Knows,
we'll keep it behind wraps. That's awesome. I'm excited to
I'm
hear
so
that.
I'm so excited too. I'm a new musician.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Music is a universal language, right? And it's truly about following your heart and your passion to do amazing things. And that's when you share your light with the world, right?
Totally. Yeah. You light up. You pretend there's like nobody there. I
correct.
See you. You just go for it.
Yeah.
I love it. So kudos to you.
Yeah.
Now, we're all value creators in some way, shape, or form. What would you say is the biggest value Elena brings to people?
The biggest value I bring to people is definitely love. Love for people, right? I just... anybody who leaves a conversation with me, you know, they know that I appreciate them for exactly who they are, wherever they come from, and I recognize the light within them and only encourage people to truly go after their passion, and that's part of the coaching business that I do, right? When it comes to transitioning entrepreneurs from their full-time, you know, or from a job to following their passion, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so the value is definitely in being able to inspire. So I inspire people,
totally.
Right? To truly follow their heart and their gifts.
Who inspires Elena? If you were to say the top three personal development gurus, you know, we've already talked music now. Let's talk about, you know, the personal development world, the self-growth world. Anyone
100%.
Inspiring you?
Oh my gosh, absolutely. So it was not until 4 years ago that I really got into this personal development world you're talking about, right?
When
that's post-corporate world,
yes.
Right? Because the corporate tends to really put the blinders on you. But yes, so we're talking about Jack Canfield has created a big impact on me, right?
And attending. Love Jack. I actually just did a summit with him. It was him and I and three other speakers.
Incredible.
Yeah, amazing guy.
Jack Canfield is amazing, you know, and looking at Tony Robbins, I like, you know, I like what he says. His style is a little bit very in your face, right?
You think?
Yes. So I would say Jack Canfield for sure.
Yeah.
An incredible coach that I'm working on, my mentor, right, as well, is Mr. Byron Nelson as well. And so he's incredibly inspirational.
Yes, yes. And the amazing. We both heard him speak just recently, so that's cool.
Yeah.
On a final note, if you were to share with our audience, three key insights, you know, as to what they can do in their own business to better themselves.
That's a very good question. Keep your vision so clear. Keep your vision clear a year from now, 5 years from now, and it be like that crazy dog chasing a rabbit, because you are the only one that knows there's a rabbit out there, right? And to everybody else, they think you're crazy. And second thing within that is, don't care about what anyone else thinks outside of your own true passion and calling. You have that vision, go for it, non-negotiable. And the third thing I would say is be consistent to your commitment to yourself, because little things repeated over the course of time create big results.
I absolutely love it. Elena, thank you so, so much
for
coming
on
the show. I'm sure we're going to cross paths numerous times, you know. I'm very, very grateful.
Thank you so much, James. Pleasure.
This is James Erdt. This is episode 29 of the Dynamo Show, where we support entrepreneurs in living well and doing good. Stay tuned. Right after this commercial break, we'll be back with one more. Welcome back to the Dynamo Show. This is James Erdt, the Chief Architect of WOW for Dynamo Entrepreneur. We support entrepreneurs in living well and doing good. And we have one entrepreneur for you today, Mr. Phil Richardson. Welcome to the show.
James, great to be your acquaintance. I'm really happy to be here.
Yes.
Thank you for the invitation.
You come highly recommended by a dear friend of ours, Ash Silva. You know, he's a good friend.
He's
been around. He's been on the show before, and
he's called the connector.
Yes, he is called the connector, and he's connected us for good reason. We have a lot of similar passions, and we're going to get into talking about those passions. But before we do, let's take it back a few years. You know, I know you have quite a story, and let's maybe talk for the first half of the show a little bit about your personal side.
Sure. Well, you know, James, I have to say to you that I've had a life of blessings.
Oh, great.
You know, I had the most wonderful parents, a wonderful upbringing. I don't have the stories to tell that so many unfortunate people do who had stress and agony, actually, in growing up. I had quite the opposite. And in fact,
You don't hear that often.
Well, it stimulated me to become a very good father. And so the most important people in my life include my four sons, who are now adults and earning a living, happy to say. And
what ages are they now?
They range in age from 32 to 42.
Okay.
And I have eight grandchildren.
Wow.
Eight.
Very cool.
And the revenge of the estrogen. Seven of them are granddaughters.
Oh, goodness.
Which is great, of course.
I love it. The revenge of the estrogen. I love that.
So they're, you know, they're really the love of my life, along with my my partner, of course, Danielle Papillon. And she and I have been life partners for some time. And also, we're business partners in our business, Take the Step Ahead. But we'll get on to that later.
Yeah, very
good. Really, I have a foundation that's second to none, and I realize how blessed I am. And, you know, it probably really sank in when my last son graduated from university and I left home.
That's awesome.
At that time, I was single, and this is some 12 years ago, and I was asked to join the development company. I'm a property developer by trade.
I was asked
to join the development company of the Sheikh of Abu Dhabi. And I was given a job that was phenomenal. And I'll talk a little more about that later. But what that did is it led me into internationalism. Mm. When my dad was in the Air Force, we lived for 4 years in Germany. And so I had a taste of it. In Zweibrücken, which is very near Frankfurt, where I know you're from.
Yeah, that's right.
I know Frankfurt rather well. And so it not only gave me the taste for it, but it also gave me the approval, if you like, to travel abroad.
Yeah.
You know.
How young were you then?
I was 12 years till 16.
Okay.
At that age.
Yeah.
And so, you know, what it is that when you assess the people who move from their home country, such as you have done, such as I have.
I'm actually Canadian. I was conceived in Frankfurt and born on Canadian soil.
I knew that.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying is that, you know, when we move into other cultures and so on, we're actually a very small minority of people. Mm-hmm. Very often it's the case that you have what we call expatriates or expats. We have far more in common with our expat friends than we do with our homelanders. Mm-hmm. And the reason for that is very simple. I found out after a while. What that is a sense of adventure. Mm. And so, you know,
good point.
I would be sitting at an expat bar on a Wednesday evening, and my friends and I would say, why don't we go to Bangkok for the weekend? And everyone would say, absolutely, see you at the airport.
Yeah.
So it's a different mentality, if you
like.
And so it led me into adventures that I never would have had I remained at home.
Yeah.
And some of them were extremely influential on my personal and spiritual growth. Mm-hmm. So, for example, and I shared with you a short story I'd written about Mumbai.
Mm-hmm. And I love Mumbai. I live part-time in Mumbai. I don't know if you knew that.
I got the impression that you did spend time there.
India. Love it.
So I was in the limousine of Tata.
Okay.
The back seat with the vice chairman.
Yeah.
We're driving along, and as you know, in the streets of Mumbai, it doesn't matter what kind of car you drive, you're all going at the same speed.
Yes.
And and so lots of horn blowing, of course.
Waiting for the sacred cow to move.
Exactly. Lots of horn blowing and so on. We stopped for a moment, and I looked out the window into the eyes of a man who was living in the entranceway to his home, a box. Mm. He was dressed in shorts, no top, some beard. Mm. We looked at each other. And at that moment, I had an epiphany. I realized that we were light years apart in terms of economic status, but he was my brother.
Humbling.
He's our brother.
Humbling.
And, you know, we often see them, these people, our brothers and sisters, in pictures. But when you're live and on the spot, you know, it's powerfully influential.
Yeah.
And it changed me dramatically. And so I would have to say that I've spent the latter part of my life getting rid of my ego.
Yeah.
And, you know, when you, I know that sounds a little odd, but the fact is, Bertrand Russell, one
Not
of my favorite philosophers, says, you know, apart from one infinitesimally small and irrelevant exception, the universe is made up of others.
Yes.
And so, you know, when you truly start to understand your place in the world and your relationship to your brothers and sisters, then you're vigilant for opportunities to give back.
So true, value creation.
And what happens is you can do that in a variety of forms and levels. Of course, there's charitable giving, but there's even more important giving, and that is in the form of giving people a net, not a fish. So that they're able then to sustain their own rise.
100%.
And now, as an individual, you have to be a little careful not get too grandiose with this.
Yeah.
You know, we're all people and we have our limitations. So, you know, you say to yourself, well, can I make a difference in such a huge place as India? Mm-hmm. Well, the fact of the matter is, yes, if enough people are inspired to do that, one person at a time, you can, in fact, be helpful.
Totally.
So I have many friends in India and in China where I lived as well.
Whereabouts in China?
In China, in Shanghai, Kunming, and Shenzhen.
Very nice.
And so,
did you pick up the language?
Well, I did, but I have to tell you, when you work as a property developer and you're building these crazy big projects, man, I'm telling you, you're going 13, 14 hours a day.
Yeah.
My language lesson occurred in the evening, right? And so sometimes I would doze off. So it wasn't as effective as it should have been.
Yeah.
But I do. I get around in a cab, let's put it that way.
Yeah, yeah, good.
But you know, when you have that sort of platform from which to work and that kind of an approach to life, what I've learned is that then you can be truly influential.
Yes.
and happy.
Yes.
Because we're actually fulfilling our purpose, which is to serve, yes. to serve others.
Yes.
And, you know, it's the case that in demanding circumstances, we tend to look inwards and we look at what it is that we need to do to eat tomorrow, right? Mm-hmm. And so we become very absorbed with that, and that's completely understandable.
It is.
But at the same time, you have to spare a dimension of yourself to grow spiritually. And, you know, I lived in cultures that were Islamist, Hindu, Buddhist, and atheist. I lived in all those cultures.
The work.
And as a Christian, mm-hmm. I learned so much more mm-hmm. about my own faith, mm-hmm. and not as a put down by any means, but I mean to say, you understand that love is really the binding element.
It is.
And, you know, love is what it is that you have to, that's the destination from which you have to come mm-hmm. and the destination to which you have to go.
Love is the answer.
Yep.
Now, if you were to share maybe three nuggets before we go to commercial break, having been that international traveler, for maybe some of the international traveling entrepreneurs that are watching this show, what three tips would you give them?
Well, I talk a lot, so I could give 300 of them, but what I would have to say is this, be humble.
Yes.
As a Canadian, so, you know, firstly, do that. Secondly, be attentive.
Yes.
And learn. Keep your mouth shut and listen. Mm-hmm. And thirdly,
two ears, one mouth.
Follow your ethics and your own practices so that people see through example who you are mm-hmm. and what you do.
Mm-hmm. Walk in the walk. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
We are going to be right back and we're going to talk about business and we are going to talk about Ferrari. Stay tuned. Welcome back to the DYNAMO Show. I am James Erdt, the Chief Architect of WOW for DYNAMO Entrepreneur, a brand that supports entrepreneurs in living well and doing good. Predominantly, we have speakers, authors, coaches, internet marketers, bloggers, people that are doing a really great thing in their community. And not only here in Canada, but we're going to talk about Abu Dhabi with Mr. Phil Richardson. Welcome back to the show.
James, real pleasure to be here. I hope I don't take too much of your time in telling you my story.
Oh, no, that's why we're here. We're going to share. You know what? I love, you know, what we've talked about a little bit behind the stage regarding Abu Dhabi, and I would love for you to share that story because it's close and dear to my heart, you know, and you know why, so I'll let you go ahead and share that.
Well, my life has been full of blessings. My background is as a property developer, specifically regional shopping centers.
Oh, great.
And I went to Dubai and Abu Dhabi in 2006 because I realized not many more of them were going to be being produced in North America, and I was right for some time because of the recession that came about.
Yep.
So on my trips there, I met the CEO of a newly formed company that turned out to be the second largest of its kind in the world, owned by the Sheikh of Abu Dhabi.
Okay.
This fellow is the CEO, just appointed, and we chatted, got along, and I joined them as the senior most development director of
Wild.
Ferrari World.
Wild.
A 2 million square foot project that is an indoor theme park. Fully air-conditioned, of course, given where it is in the Sahara Desert. And it was built right beside our Formula One racetrack that we also constructed, along with 7 hotels, a huge super-regional shopping center. Give you an idea of what 2 million square feet looks like. It's bigger than square one.
Oh, boy. That's a lot of footage.
And the shopping center...
I look down on it.
Yeah, the shopping center's twice as big.
Yeah, wow.
To which it's attached.
Oh, my goodness.
And Warner Brothers theme park, we added a third. And an outdoor water park. It was on steroids. So, you know, how did this all go about? Well, I was on the steering committee for the development of this project. And so my colleagues were Luca di Montezemolo, the chairman of Ferrari.
Wow.
Jean Todt, the CEO of Ferrari.
Hello.
The CEO of our company and myself. Yeah. And the first two were living legends in racing, of course. And here I was on a first name basis with them all of a sudden. I was like, I had
how
to pinch myself all the time, really.
I bet.
How lucky is that? Had I remained at home, this wouldn't have happened. So basically what I did was I worked very closely with them, and I learned so much about Ferrari. And here, this is a very important learning experience I had. One day I'm sitting in front of Jean Todt in his office, and I said, you know, Jean, I would love to know how it is that Ferrari is maintained its huge popularity, its strong brand, and its financial success year to year to year. I mean, how is that done? He says, you would like to know that? He says, picks up the phone and to an old friend of mine, Mario Almato, the COO, and he says, Mario, take Phil out for a long Italian lunch and tell him everything there is to know about Ferrari. No holes barred.
Oh.
I had a $1 million business seminar, and then I had a whole succession of them later. I would go anywhere within Ferrari, including their top secret racing development areas, without any pass. Oh, and so I learned a tremendous amount. And what I learned was some key lessons, internationalization being the main one from Ferrari. Their team spans the whole world.
Yeah.
They get the best of people to contribute to the building and maintaining of their brand. So that lesson really impressed me, and I realized that in North America, you know, we've been so prosperous and so affluent that we really haven't maintained our competitiveness. We think we have, but then when we're confronted with competitors who come internationally, we find out they eat our lunch.
Yes.
And the reason they do is they're using what are called global best practices to do it.
Nice.
So it inspired me and my partner to form a company called Take the Step Ahead.
Ah, yes.
And through it, what we do is I provide CEO coaching around the world. Mm-hmm. I have CEOs for whom I provide one-on-one coaching because there's no lonelier job than being a CEO. Having been one, I know what that is.
Yeah, yeah, I agree.
And you need to have
lonely at the top. It's
true. You need to have that interaction to get honest.
Honest sounding board.
So I do that for people in Riyadh, Abu Dhabi, Shanghai, Mumbai, as well as in Canada. And secondly, we give classes, master classes, and our website is takethestepahead.com. And there you'll find what we offer are guidance and real instruction. We don't like to have people leave our classes without actually knowing what they can do and being able to make money with it. So so that's how we now conduct our business, and it fulfills the mission I feel I have, which is...
Do they come to you, or do you go to them?
They come to us now.
How do they find you?
Yeah, in Toronto.
Through the website?
We have offices in Phoenix, but our website is takethestepahead.com.
I guess it's probably a lot of word of mouth, too. A lot of
it is,
know each other. It's small at the top.
We're getting a lot of testimonials, because when people leave our classes, they are ready to go. They're ready to actually make money out of doing what we're doing. As an entrepreneur.
Practical, not only theoretical.
Absolutely. And so, I mean, it's one thing to be motivational, but then, now what do you do with it?
Yeah, true.
You've got to have the knowledge, right? So, you know, the result is that we provide this to people. They find that they really do profit from what we offer. And the result of that is that they end up not only spreading the word, but spreading the prosperity. And that's our mission. That's our mission. We think more people should come internationally to compete with us, but we need to be ready to return the favor and maintain our position within our own country and internationally as well. So that's our mission.
I love it. Global business practices. Isn't that the key these days?
Best practices.
I mean, best practices of what's going on right now in the world. I mean, we're becoming so connected, you know, and I'm sure you've seen, like, just, you know, over your years, going from, you know, the analog world to the digital world, the big change. And what would you say is different nowadays compared to even, say, like, 20, 30 years ago? What would you say is the biggest difference?
The acceleration of pace. So, for example, we see all of these new medical solutions coming to market at what seems like a quick pace. And that's because they benefit from what is called 24/7 R&D. People have formed teams globally around the world. They hand off to others. And as they do, of course, the solutions come up more quickly.
Yes.
And so that interconnectivity is also an important aspect. Marshall McLuhan, our famous Canadian philosopher, said the medium is the message. And in fact, it is. What it does is when you have that interconnection so that you're very comfortable in dealing with somebody in Shanghai, Mumbai, Dubai at the same time, as you discussed, you see what a global village really is in operation. You get the benefit of all these great inputs and so on, and it makes you better. Mm-hmm.
Now, let's say a CEO, they come to you guys and talk a little bit about the process. What does it look like when a CEO arrives with you? step one?
Well, first of all, you know, what we do is we verify that the chemistry is right. Mm-hmm. If that's not there,
isn't
there's
that
not
key?
Much value that
oh,
could
yeah.
be that could be exchanged. Yeah. But happily, you know, I'm a reasonable communicator, and you know, many CEOs are as well, and so they see the value in what we can offer. Mm. And it's the bringing of these solutions, like from survivalist countries, although they're becoming very prosperous, China and India. Mm-hmm. You get people who, if they don't innovate, they don't eat. Mm-hmm. And so they're obviously more motivated than you and I might be, let's say, in a given day, to actually, you know, really do something important. So they produce these global best practices through trial and error. They share them with us, mm-hmm. and in turn, I share them with these CEOs. Mm. So they get a perspective. One in Riyadh says, what would I do if I were in Australia or if I were in the US? What would the solutions be to this particular problem?
Yeah.
I bring those solutions to them.
Ah, nice. Very good. Anyone that stands out in your mind, a student, a success story?
Well, I can't, you know, by the nature of the relationship, I can't name names, but these are all very high profile people.
Yeah.
But, you know, I want to just diverge a bit from that for a moment and remember that we have hundreds of graduates of our master classes. Mm-hmm. And so it doesn't matter what station in life people are, they're all important to me. And if I can be helpful with them, as my partner wishes to be as well, she's trained over 60,000 people in her career. That together, what we are able to do, we see each person as a success story for us, because we know that when I go off and contribute to their own prosperity, mm-hmm. they're contributing to the prosperity of their families, their friends, their colleagues, and so on. So in a small way, mm-hmm. we're giving back in a way that I believe is helpful, and it certainly makes us feel satisfied.
And I love it, because she is going to be on our show in the future.
Absolutely, so Danielle Papillon. She's the real power here in this relationship.
Oh, I love it.
Yeah,
love
she's
it,
fantastic.
Love it.
She'll tell you a story about how we met 19 years ago, and you'll be enthralled with it. But I'll leave it to her to tell.
One of her students.
I'll be telling. I'd like to say, you know, finally that, you know, we're all people.
Yes.
We're all here to help one another.
Yes.
We have a choice. We can opt for fear, mm-hmm. or we can opt for love. And love is the choice that we want to make.
Love and lack of love.
Sometimes that can be difficult to do, because in the face of, we all have our fears and so on, mm-hmm. but we have to pave the way so that love takes priority. It's really the difference between good and evil. Mm-hmm. Love is good. And so to the degree that we can, we try to exemplify that ourselves in whatever we do. And it's been so nice to be with you today, James.
Phil Richardson, thank you so much for joining me.
It's been my pleasure.
I look forward to seeing you possibly on the racetrack someday.
Well, I have many stories to tell, but we'll leave it until then.
I'm a Mercedes guy, by the way, but I love Ferraris. I drive Ferraris, you know, but we won't go there right yet.
I had a 360.
Woo! All right, this is the Dynamo Show with Phil Richardson. This is episode 29, and we will see you on episode 30. Thank you so much for tuning in.